We're learning a lot more about the new Resident Evil. It's a Netflix and Ubisoft team up to celebrate ancient Greek mythology. And a video game industry veteran who went on to lead a sports team comes back to games. All that and the latest in everything cool today in The Rundown. Welcome to the show, everybody. Boy, we've got lots of fun things to talk about. Today, this one is dedicated to XGR Extensive Game Reviews, who said that yesterday's rundown sure was the latest in everything cool. Thank you so much for that. And you know what? We've got more cool for you. How about some new info on Resident Evil? Earlier today, the fine folks at Capcom streamed the Resident Evil Showcase to talk about Resident Evil 8 Village, and they showed us some new footage in a trailer and also took us through some of the gameplay for the game. They announced that the game is going to be coming out May 7th, 2021. It's going to be playable on new consoles, PlayStation 5, Xbox Series consoles, but also last-gen machines, Xbox One and PlayStation 4. There's also an upgrade path. You can get a free upgrade to the next-gen versions of the game if you buy them on the cloud. Classic consoles and then upgrade your consoles later on, which is pretty cool. And of course, there are the requisite collector's edition packs that come with all kinds of little goodies, little action figures and bobbleheads and extra weaponry and some cool cases and stuff like that. Really cool looking. But there was a lot more. We got a real taste of gameplay. We're going to be playing as Ethan Winters again from Resident Evil 7. We're carrying on with his story and we're going to be encountering all kinds of ghouls, some blood-sucking ghouls that want man blood, which was really creepy. And so we're going to be encountering everything in first person just like we did in Resident Evil 7. There was no news about VR support for the PlayStation platforms, but maybe that's going to be something that will be added in because, of course, Resident Evil 7 was an awesome VR experience. But the game looks incredibly rich and lush and super hyper detailed, all kinds of beautiful lighting and lots of ornate work done with the decorations of the castle. And you can see the light gleaming off of the gold and everything. It's just absolutely stunning. And, of course, lots of great jump scares. There's also going to be a free PS5 exclusive demo called Maiden available later today. And for those that missed Resident Evil 7, you can actually buy the two games together in a bundle. But it's also the 25th anniversary of Resident Evil, so Capcom wanted to celebrate in a bunch of different ways. We got a taste of the animated series that's coming to Netflix called Resident Evil Infinite Darkness, which is coming later this year. And it's following Claire and Leon, and it's set a few years after the events of Resident Evil 4, which is really cool. A nice surprise, there's some new costumes and stuff that you can download into The Division 2, which is pretty rad, celebrating the Resident Evil franchise. And there was also news on Reverse, the new Resident Evil multiplayer experience, which is in closed beta, and they're taking applications right now, and it's going to be a part of the package if you buy Resident Evil 8 Village, but presumably it will build on some of the experiments that Capcom has done with multiplayer Resident Evil in the past. And Brittany Brombacker from What's Good Games did a great job hosting the event, and honestly, it was a very effective tool to get us hyped for the games that we're going to be playing in 2021. We don't have long to wait for Resident Evil 8 Village either. It comes out May 7th, and something else we don't have long to wait for is this partnership between Netflix and Ubisoft. File this one in the cool partnership department. Netflix, that has a show called Blood of Zeus, and Ubisoft, which has a game called Immortals Phoenix Rising, both dealing with classic Greek mythology as part of their storytelling, have entered into a partnership. And what's really interesting about this is that both projects, Immortals Phoenix Rising and Blood of Zeus, star Elias Tufexis, and I think that's just incredible. And so for a week, starting today, January 21st until January 28th, players of Immortals Phoenix Rising can go on a special mission. It's called A Tribute to Family, and they can fight two evil creatures that are from another world. One of them is Chimera, and the other is Cerberus. When you complete the quest, you're going to be getting an eagle pendant and some character customization for your character in Immortals Phoenix Rising. And I just think that this is such a wonderful idea, mostly because I think both properties need a little bit of attention here. They're both very cool projects. Blood of Zeus has actually been renewed for a second season, so apparently it is doing quite well. I don't know how Immortals Phoenix Rising is doing sales-wise. I know that a lot of people across the industry talk very highly of the game. I really have been enjoying the game as well. It just came out at a very crowded time. It came out with Watch Dogs, Legions, and Assassin's Creed Valhalla within weeks of each other. These three massive open-world Ubisoft Adventures, but Immortals Fenyx Rising is a brand new IP. It's definitely much more accessible, much more kind of family-friendly than the traditional M-rated open-world experiences that Ubisoft is so famous for, and it has all of that learning and experience imbued in the game, but it also delivers a very easy-to-spot homage to Nintendo's incredible Breath of the Wild, and it is super accessible to jump in and start having fun and start playing. Of course, the map in Immortals Fenyx Rising gets, you know, populated with all kinds of activities and things to do, and it can be a little bit, you know, confusing which way you can go, but the thing that's cool about Immortals Fenyx Rising is that it doesn't really matter which direction you take as Phoenix, you're gonna have some fun. You know, the character's got all kinds of great abilities, and now as we're moving forward with this adventure as kind of a games as service idea, Ubisoft can throw in all kinds of new live type content like this. I think that this is a natural fit, this connection with Blood of Zeus, which is crafted by the same folks that brought us the Castlevania animated show. So there is a darkness and a heaviness. It's much darker and bloodier than Immortals Fenyx Rising, so it does feel a little incongruous when you kind of pair the two together. But, of course, they're dealing with similar subject matter and a lot of the same types of characters. Illustrated differently, Immortals is absolutely a lot more sort of tongue-in-cheek and it constantly breaks the fourth wall. Blood of Zeus is a little more heavy-handed, takes itself a little bit more seriously. Both really impressive projects, and I just get a big kick out of this. I'm sure Elias Tufexis is just sitting there going, I don't know how this happened, but these two projects that happened for him during the pandemic have ended in partnership, which is just crazy. All right, something else that's a little bit crazy is the news that Peter Moore has returned to video games. One of the coolest executives to ever pass through the video game industry has come back to video games. He went on to become the CEO of the Liverpool Football Club, which I know was a lifelong dream of his, but he has returned. He had long stints with Sega, with Microsoft, with Electronic Arts. He's incredibly famous for revealing the release date of Halo 2 as a tattoo on his arm, and I was at that E3, and I couldn't believe that he did it, but he really did do it. I was also lucky enough to be able to interview him on stage at the External Development Summit a few years ago, and that was a terrific conversation. It was actually on the anniversary, the 20-year anniversary of the launch of Dreamcast, and he was there during the Dreamcast era. So he's got an incredibly storied career. He always comes to his jobs with a tremendous amount of passion and a sense of wisdom because he had marketing in his background before he got into the video game industry. And he's taking that experience and he's joining Unity as the senior VP and GM of sports and live entertainment. He announced all that in a tweet. And of course, it sent shockwaves throughout the industry. I think everybody's got a Peter Moore story to talk about in the video game business. And honestly, I'm just super happy that he's back. It was kind of a sad day when we heard that Peter Moore was leaving games because he's just been a natural fit in our industry for so long. So kudos to Peter and kudos to Unity, which is clearly making some pretty epic moves. Apparently, sports and live entertainment is going to be a big part of what Unity's got to offer going forward. Esports continues to grow and grow. And as you guys can remember, one of Peter's sort of last positions with Electronic Arts was to kind of think about esports and their sports games over there. So clearly he's taking all of that EA Sports know-how and those relationships and the relationships that he's got throughout not just the football leagues out there, but other sports leagues as well into this new position. So expect exciting things from Peter Moore over at Unity. Now I've got some other news tidbits to share with you guys. I've been getting a ton of trailers for indie games that look super cool crossing my desk, but also this collection of Turrican titles called Turrican Flashback. And Turrican was a very cool game series in the 90s. It was an action-adventure shooter hybrid. It was kind of like a fast-paced Metroid with really cool effects and wonderful music. All of that stuff is being recreated here. There's four different Turrican games in this collection. I've got a review code of this title, so I'll have some thoughts on the game very soon for you guys, but it looks super cool. I have played Turrican 1 and 2 before, and they are so fast and so slick, so I'm looking forward to diving into this collection. I also got the news on Ocean's Heart, which launches today on Steam, and Zelda.GOG. This is a Zelda-like. It certainly looks like classic 16-bit Zelda. It was made by one person named Max Mraz, and it looks delightful. It looks like it's a very cool adventure with lots of puzzles and lots of cute characters to encounter, lots of side quests that you go on. The trailer is definitely put together with a sense of humor and, as the title implies, a sense of heart. And I am very much looking forward to checking this one out. It's called Ocean's Heart. Devolver also shot me the launch trailer for Olia. This is a fantasy adventure, hack and slasher, super retro pixel art. It looks super cool as well. There's clearly a great deal of effort put into telling a cool story here with this one. And it looks like it's going to deliver on all kinds of that Dead Cells kind of hack and slash exploration that we're all craving, right? Olia looks like it's going to be a lot of fun. That comes out January 28th. And finally, Cyber Shadow comes out next week as well. I can't wait for this one. It's a brand new one from Yacht Club Games and Mechanical Head, and it looks fast, it looks intense, and it looks like crazy amounts of fun. Kind of like a fusion between Shinobi and Ninja Gaiden, little Metroidvania type stuff in there. Lots of cool bosses to battle and enemies to slice and dice. I can't wait to get my hands on this game, and I promise as soon as I do, I'm going to live stream it so we can share in the fun together. Thank you for watching today, you guys. That's going to do it for our rundown, but I'll be back again tomorrow with a brand new episode for you. Thank you for subscribing to the channel. Thank you for becoming an EPN member. Thank you for sharing our content with people out there. We'll see you tomorrow. And until then, play forever.